The Four Pivots, Reimagining Justice, Reimagining Ourselves, by Shawn A. Ginwright, PhD. Narrated by the author. Published by North Atlantic Books. This book is dedicated to my father, William Benjamin Ginwright, Jr., affectionately known as Papa G. Your love and light always guide me through the wilderness of life. Acknowledgments. The journey for this book began at the black kitchen table in my dining room. This is where my friends and family gathered to enjoy wine, a great meal, and each other's company. More than anything, the black kitchen table is where wild ideas are born. One night over dinner and a few glasses of wine, I shared my idea for this book. Neither my friend and baby sister Jennifer Johns nor my wife Nedra was impressed by what I had shared, and they pushed me to write something that was out of my comfort zone and spoke to a broader audience. They both challenged me to share what was really inside my head and heart and dared me to think beyond the confines of my professional and academic training. I'm not one to back down from a good dare, and this book would not have been possible without the rich conversations with Jennifer and Nedra. My family also dared me to integrate my life into the insights in this book. I'm forever grateful for my mother, Mae Ginwright, Aunt Sylvia Ginwright, Aunt Joyce Ballard, and my two brothers, Chris and Graylin, whose love is tucked in between every word. My children, Takai and Naya Ginwright, are the artist and push my artistic limits, nudging me to unlock the artist within me. Thanks, kids, for teaching me and leading me and showing me the power of a story well told. Writing a book is like embarking on a long and uncertain journey. You might know the destination, but you're never precisely sure how to get there. Luckily, I've been blessed by many guides during my trip. David and Miko Hawkins, my brother and sister, reminded me of the responsibility to stay grounded, yet push me to fly. Dr. Macheo Payne and Mark Anthony Ellis are my intellectual pirates, whose compass always points me north, no matter what storms may come. I've been blessed with a mighty team of dreamers and doers and pioneers who have shown me what it looks like to take flight. Thanks to everyone on the Flourish Agenda team, they lead me to the edge and, with a soft whisper, remind me that I have wings. Thank you, Dr. Denisha Carley, for your painstaking review, edits, and comments. Your finger snaps and LOLs and pointing out inconsistencies were invaluable. Dr. Vanessa Grubbs, you raised the bar for eloquence in writing. Thanks for your early reviews. Deb Kersey worked hard on making sure to carve out time for me to write, no matter how packed my calendar might have been. Dr. Julio Camarota is more than a friend, but my intellectual soulmate, whose life is an example combining scholarship and justice. Cy Siegel, your curious skepticism and feminist voice were always at the forefront of my thinking. Mia Haywood Jones, I'm grateful for our ride together, and you cleared the road and solved problems that I didn't even know were there. Dr. Christina V. Villarreal and Dr. Farima Poor Khorshid, words cannot express how you have sharpened these ideas, deepened my thinking, and illuminated my life. The truth is, the black kitchen table belongs to all of us. And without Nedra, none of these ideas would find root in our lives. Nedra, there's so much love you give, and I can only hope that this book will pour light into the lives of everyone who hears it, the same way you have done with so many others. Introduction. I used to think that my job as a professor was to teach. I had entered graduate school in 1994, eager to learn about educating students and improving schools. I was trained to read, research, contemplate, analyze, and write about all I had learned, then impart knowledge to my eagerly awaiting students. I remember my first day as an assistant professor at Santa Clara University, feeling completely insecure, overwhelmed, and over my head. I walked around campus in fear that someone would find out that I had no idea what I was doing. My fear of being found out made me avoid talking to certain colleagues, determined how I would enunciate words, and influenced even how I dressed. If I could speak, dress, and behave like a professor, I thought, then no one would find out that I really wasn't. It was my secret, and I was determined to hide it from my students and my colleagues at all costs. So I kept my secret safe, neatly tucked just beneath a fragile, thin veneer of confidence I could muster up on my walks across campus. Years later, when I thought my fear had disappeared, it unexpectedly showed up again. During a graduate seminar, I began to notice how despondent and disconnected my students were to the material. When I asked them questions about the reading, they simply didn't respond. At first, I thought it was because they hadn't read the material. After a few weeks of this, I abruptly stopped the class and straight out asked them why no one had read the material. One student replied, "Dr. Ginwright, did you actually read your own syllabus?" I was puzzled and replied with confidence, "Of course I've read the syllabus. I designed a course." I was somewhat perturbed by her question. Yet another student commented, "Did you read all of your syllabus?" By now, I knew something was wrong. So I glanced down at the title of my syllabus. It read, "African American Social Theory, Spring 2007. The class I was teaching was in the fall of 2012. I was mortified that I had failed to update the readings and revise the material for timely and relevant examples. Immediately, my fear, the one that I thought had somehow disappeared, showed up again and was staring me right in the face. So I did what any insecure, fear-filled professor would do. I lied to save face. I replied in my confident, proper, deep professor voice, "Well, the theoretical underpinnings of sociological phenomena remain in Black life, and these readings, while dated, are classic and still relevant to blah, 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 blah." They could see that I was bullshitting and hiding from the truth, which was simply that I had majorly fucked up. After escaping the embarrassment of the moment, I had two decisions to make. I could use my position and power as a professor to sweep my mistake under the rug, or I could come clean and tell them the truth. I chose the latter, to tell the truth. The following week, after deep reflection and contemplation, I came into class and had an honest conversation about my mistake. I admitted that I hadn't been as organized and thoughtful about the course as I should have been. I didn't make excuses, but I explained that I was tired. Not the kind of tired you can just sleep off and wake up the next day and be cool. Nah, I was tired down to the roots at my core. I was tired of meaningless meetings, tired of constantly raising money for my work, tired of not knowing where I was going in life. I apologized to them from my gut because I really value my students' learning. I didn't just mimic the words, "I'm sorry," or "my bad." I was truly regretful, and they knew it. They could feel me. You feel me? That conversation transformed the class and my relationships with my students in ways that I could not imagine. I suspect that somewhere in the clumsy apology, they stopped seeing me as Professor Ginwright and began to see me as fully human. I imagine that in me standing in front of the class, somewhere in my stumbling over words, they saw something familiar, something they could relate to, my imperfection. They trusted what I said because it was real. No theoretical underpinnings, no framework, no philosophical point, no bullshit, just damn honest. I said to them, "I messed up, and I hope to regain your trust. I'm gonna do better." I suppose that my being honest and vulnerable allowed me to let go of my fear and in doing so opened something in us that connected us beyond the confines of teacher and student. For the rest of our semester together, we played, we laughed, cried, and relished in simply being human. We healed. I think that much of what we know about healing is wrong. Well, not entirely wrong, but rather incomplete. For most of my career as an advocate for youth, nonprofit leader, and professor, I've thought about healing as a process focused on fixing harms and/or repairing wounds inflicted by oppression and structural inequality. But I've come to realize that as a society, we don't really do a good job at preparing, teaching, or training people how to be vulnerable, cultivate empathy, practice self-reflection, all of the stuff that makes us human. Healing involves more than repairing the deep wounds of racism, healing the scars of sexism, or easing the pains of poverty. Healing is the capacity to restore our humanity and care for ourselves and others, even in the midst of our fear. Healing is the only pathway to real justice because it requires that we take an honest look at what harmed us and pushes us to restore our humanity and finally to move us confidently into a possible future. While my training as a graduate student at UC Berkeley prepared me with deep analysis of our social problems, I wasn't given the tools to deal with my own trauma, fears, and insecurities. I believe that my analysis of social problems was enough to change them. But I was wrong. Of course, I didn't know I was wrong 30 years ago when I founded an organization that focused on training thousands of Black youth to analyze social problems, build power, and change their schools and communities. Since that time, I've learned that changing things that are broken in our society requires individual and collective healing. I've learned from young people, their families, and community partners all the lessons that were missing from my graduate school training. They have taught me that the most important aspect of social change is not problem analysis, power building, narrative change, or coalition building. It's healing. The regularity of mass shootings, innocent citizens gunned down by police, urban youth violence, and rural opioid use among youth all have one thing in common. They are symptoms of a society that is broken. Americans are more depressed, commit suicide more frequently, and have little hope in the future, and our leaders have no idea about what to do about it. America's capitalist culture is based in individualism, fear, and scarcity is toxic and has taken a toll on how we work, live, and relate to one another. We can feel it when we go to work, we can see it when we turn on the television, and we can hear it when we listen to the news. The solutions to these challenges won't be found through progressive or conservative politics. A deeper shift is needed in our values and our ability to heal from the wounds of racism, sexism, and poverty. I sometimes think we grossly underestimate how inequality impacts us. I'm not talking about inequality in the sense of wage gaps and unemployment or access to quality health care. I think we all are familiar with all the evidence from research about these types of inequality. I'm more curious about the less obvious ways that inequality impacts us, how inequality erodes hope, shatters dreams, and breeds othering. Imagine if your home had asbestos and lead paint everywhere. In addition to that, you live next to a factory that spewed toxic fumes into the air. Over time, these toxins would eventually have an impact on your health and well-being. You might develop a slight but stubborn cough that won't go away. Your slight cough then turns into a nasty chest infection that ultimately begins to weaken your breathing, and so on. Y'all get the picture. That's what inequality does to us.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.